Without further ado, I'd like to just introduce the Honorable Bob McEwen. And I say the Honorable because he was congressman in Ohio, and we get an opportunity to hear him today. He is a senior advisor with nationally recognized law firm Greenbaum, Dole, and McDonald. But he was a representative in United States House of Representatives for Ohio for six terms. During his congressional service, Bob was asked to serve as a special president envoy for both President Reagan's and Bush, and U.S. representative to the European Parliament from 85 to 93. I'll say this, I was able to participate in a gathering with some pastors and some other folks in Detroit, and I heard Congressman McEwen speak, and I've seen him and been around him for quite a few years, and but I remember when he was talking there, how he captured some things, how he talked about them, and how he talks about just America was so, I just think it was so clear. And sometimes we try to figure out, what is this thing about America? What is this thing about American exceptionalism? And what is all this about? And I think you're going to really enjoy Congressman McEwen today. And let's give him a warm, cure welcome as he comes and greets us. Thank you.
Thank you so much.
Thank you so much, sir. Appreciate that.
I'm honored to be here. I feel like I'm at home. I'm delighted to be here. I am an admirer of Star Parker, and I quote her a lot. In fact, I was thinking on the way over here, I was doing a radio interview yesterday, and I quoted her twice. She understands what our dilemma is. And there is, if you were to ask me, what's the most important thing I've ever learned in my life, it would be this, that everything in life is either physical or spiritual. And wisdom is the capacity to tell which is which. And you cannot achieve spiritual ends with physical tools. The scripture says that the fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace. And so I think if I physically have enough relationships, I'll achieve love. No, you won't. If I get a new car or a new house, then I'll be happy. No, you won't. If I just smoke this, man, we just smoke this, I'll just drink, I'll be at peace. I'll be at peace, man. No, you won't. You cannot do anything physically to achieve a spiritual end. If you do it just the opposite. Let us suppose that you want to build a building, which is physical. And so we're going to go out and sit in a parking lot, and we're going to have love and joy and peace. We're going to have all these spirit. You can't build a physical building with spiritual tools. So wisdom is understanding which is which. Otherwise, you waste your time trying. And so then you start to think a little bit. And what is leadership? Leadership is spiritual. That is, you can quote a great leader, but that doesn't get the job done. You've all seen in a ball game. You see momentum. Momentum is spiritual. And in the course of accomplishing what we want to accomplish, America, when George Washington, it was December 23rd, and he started out the summer of 1776, and now everybody had abandoned him. His army was less than a fourth of what it was. They either gotten sick or left, and had lost every battle. And on January 1st, the enlistments are up. And so there's about 7,500 of them just laying around on the ground, freezing to death there in Pennsylvania. And Washington wrote to his cousin down at Mount Vernon. He says, I fear this thing is about up. Because unless they had a victory, everybody was just staying long enough to get paid, and that was going to be it. His prayer partner and founder of the American Bible Society, Benjamin Rush, came down, and they said, you know, unless we get a victory of some sort. And so they decided that they would go down and cross the Delaware on Christmas Day, and that they would attack the soldiers there that had enough supplies and ammunition to last them throughout the entire year. But he said this. He said the password was liberty or death. Yeah. But then he said, post none but Americans on guard tonight. You say, wait, they all got the uniform. Aren't they all American? No, being an American is spiritual. You know, you and I can't become Japanese or Chinese. Anybody can become an American because American is spiritual. And spiritual, and unless we understand the uniqueness as to why this place, and this little place, 4% of the population of the world, you know, for thousands of years, people hoped to someday fly. It was Americans that invented the airplane and the light bulb and the telegraph and the telephone and the global positioning system and the internet, put men on the moon, the air conditioner. Every year, more books, more plays, more symphonies, more copyrights, more inventions than the other 96% combined. Now why? Are we smarter than everybody else? Of course not. Do we work harder than anybody else? No. There is a value system. The scripture says that righteousness exalteth a nation. Sin is a reproach to any people. When the righteous are in authority, the people rejoice. When the wicked beareth rule, the people. Blessed is the nation whose God is the Lord. And so when we have a value system that is in coordination with what he says, we prosper. When we move away from that, we get the consequences. And that's all the Old Testament was all about, is that God would restore and say, everybody do it right, and get a new leader, and then after a little while, well, we don't need to do that anymore. And the next generation says, yeah, our parents were old fogies, you know. And then they go, and just over and over and over. So to try to explain just a couple of quick points as to how it works, certain principles that function and which principles that don't. First of all, let me just talk about half of all the people on earth live on less than $2 a day. Half of those live on less than $1 a day. The second richest spot on earth is Western Europe, France, Germany, Britain. A person in poverty in America, Wall Street Journal, Heritage Foundation, Rector study done every 24 months for now 37 years. A person living in poverty in America is more likely to have a telephone, a television. Now, many of us in this room grew up without television. Now, if your teenager doesn't have his own television, he thinks he's deprived. But nevertheless, a telephone, a television, an air conditioner, an automobile. There are more automobiles in America than there are registered drivers. Eats more meat, has more square footage space. A person living in poverty has more square footage than the average resident of the second richest spot on earth, Western Europe. Now, the question would have to be why? And that's what I hope to answer, unless if we don't understand it, we'll elect people who want to fundamentally change America, and then there'll be no place for us to go. Let me talk about economics. I majored in economics, and it's called the dismal science, and they say that economists are people that are good with numbers, but they didn't have the personality to be an accountant. And so let me just walk through just a little bit. Let us suppose this represents 100% of your income, 100% of the income of any city or a state or a nation. Let us say it represents a $100 bill. And if you go into Walmart and the most expensive thing in the store is $99, that means that you are completely free to choose anything in the store. Now, let us suppose that someone comes along and takes 25% of it away from you. Two things happen. You have fewer choices. There are some choices that you can no longer make. Thomas Jefferson said, freedom is having choices. The more choices I take away from you, the less freedom you have. Anybody ever had a teenager has had this fight. So the more money I take, you have fewer choices, and you have a lower standard of living. I mean, if I take money, unless you're with the New York Times, this is really quite elementary. For them, it would be a profundity. But the more money I take away, suppose I come along, I take half. What? Fewer choices, less freedom, lower. Suppose someone comes along, takes 75, leaves you with 25. What happened? Even fewer choices, even less freedom, even lower standard. Suppose someone comes along and takes it all. What we call a person who works all day and keeps absolutely nothing, that person is called a slave. Now, there are two people that can come and take money away from you. One is called a criminal. He comes and he takes money away from you. The other is called a politician. And he comes and he takes money away from you. Now, here's the point. You know, they say in public speaking that when you want to emphasize a point, you're supposed to pause for emphasis. So I am now going to pause for emphasis because the impact is the same. You go to the pay window, you pick up your money, you're walking across the parking lot, a fella comes up, puts a gun in your ribs, says, I want 50% of everything that you've got. You go home, you sit down with your wife and children. This is how much money we have for food, this is the kind of car we can drive, this is the kind of vacation we can take. Or you make it all the way to your truck, you open up the paycheck and you say, Uncle Sam's already been here. The money's already gone. The impact is the same. And so, you show me what percentage of the gross domestic product, that is, take all the goods and services in a nation, you show me what percentage of the GDP of any city or any state or any nation goes to government. I don't need to know the name, it doesn't matter. And the principle applies that the greater the freedom, the greater the wealth. The greater the government, the greater the poverty. And it only works this way every time. And politics is just a simple question of where we are on this chart. And, it jumped back really quickly. That was good. You show me on this, politics is a simple question. Where do we go on this chart from one direction to the other? If you understand this principle, you can make any rich place poor or any poor place rich. And now that you know the principle, I can take you and I can fly you in an airplane and you can land in Buenos Aires and then you go to Cairo and then you go to Tegucigalpa, Honduras, and you go and you just get out and drive around for an hour and get back in the airplane and fly away, and you'll be able to put them on that chart. And that's what politics is all about. So a couple of quick examples that this is a place, whoops, don't go too fast. This is a place called Nagasaki. At the end of World War II, it wasn't in very good condition, but it got freedom. And there is what Nagasaki looks like today under liberty. Now, in economics, they like to say the reason Americans are rich is because we had lots of natural resources, we have temperate climate, we have any problem, every hogwash story you can come up with. But so I like to use, you can show any place. You want to talk about natural resources? Hong Kong is built on a rock. There are no natural resources at all. Hong Kong, and up until 1999, was under control of the British. It was free. China was communist. And so you could see one or the other. Same heritage, same culture, same climate, same everything. One had the output per person, the productivity per person of a resident of Hong Kong was 40 times, 4-0, 40 times greater than just across the water to China with all of his heritage and all of his culture and all of his natural resources and everything else. You could do it with East and West Germany. There are some people in this room old enough to remember when the wall came down between East Germany and West Germany. Same culture, language, climate, everything was the same. But when the wall came down, those on the West had a standard of living 14 times higher than those on the right. So at the end of the Korean War, is there anyone in this room that was in the Korean War by any chance? It's often called the Forgotten War, and we overlook those folks. When they divided the country at the 38th parallel, North Korea got 75% of the arable land and socialism. South Korea, same heritage, culture, climate, language, 25% of the arable land. And at that point, there are no 60-year-old trees in South Korea because people were starving to death and they would take the bark off the trees and boil it for water just to stay alive. And it was third from the bottom of all the nations on earth. It was the third poorest nation on earth. However, some years later, in North Korea, over the last 5 years, 2.5 million people have starved. Now, what do? Food, clothing, shelter. First thing you do is food. If anything else falls apart, they can't even do that. They eat sticks and leaves to fill their stomach. South Korea has the 10th largest GDP on the planet. And if you will just look in your pocket, you can see that you've contributed to that with your Samsung or your LG TV or something. Now, what's the difference? Anything you want to say different? Well, the difference is freedom. The greater the freedom, and so at the time that South Korea was the third poorest city on earth, third poorest nation, you want to know what the richest city in the world was? Far and away, not even close, like 18%, nearly 20%. Richest city in the history of mankind, a place called Detroit, Michigan. Richest city. There are more three-story single-family dwellings there than any place else on earth. The richest city in the world at the same time that South Korea was third from the bottom. But they elected some folks in Detroit, said, we can put a stop to this. And so they... and so 50 years later, 50 years later, this is the train station. It was dedicated 100 years ago last year. It was considered the most beautiful public building in the world. People would come there just to see the murals and things that were in the Detroit train station, and there it is currently. At the time that there are 48,000. Anybody from Detroit here? Okay. There are 48,000 single-family dwellings in Detroit. They're not uninhabited or uninhabitable. and the population, as you know, has now. Now, if someone comes along, if I come to an intersection and criminals get around my car and they take half of everything I have, how many days would I have to do that before I didn't go through that intersection? All right. Let's call it a city. And every time I come through that city, they take half of everything. How long would it take me to leave? Well, the population of Detroit is now smaller than it was in 1900. So why? Because you can make any rich place poor if you understand the principle, because you can turn around. Now, the question would be, why? Okay, all right, Bob, you've got empirical data, but why is that? And that's where most people don't explain. I think I can explain. It goes like this. Let us suppose you're going to buy something for yourself. You care about two things. You care about price, and you care about quality. And nobody can make that decision as well as you can. When you're spending your own money, you might pay $4 for a cup of coffee at 7 in the morning, for which you wouldn't pay 50 cents at 2:30 in the afternoon. When it's your money, spending it for yourself, you get the maximum benefit. You care about two things. You care about price and quality. Now, let us suppose that you don't control one of those things. Let us suppose that you're going to buy something for someone else, for a gift. Do you care about the price? Yes, because you're paying for it. But you're a little more flexible on the quality. By the time it breaks, they'll be married. By the time this thing breaks, they'll be married 4 years. They'll forget who gave it to them anyway. This will be fine. We've all bought things for people we never would have bought for ourselves. We've all received things as gifts. We care about the price, yes, but we're not so concerned about the quality. Now, let us suppose we're going to receive something and not pay for it. Do we care about the quality? Yes, we care about the quality because we're going to consume it. And so the waitress comes around and says, would you like to have some orange juice? And you say, well, how much is it? And she says, well, it's $3 a glass. You say, well, really, I'm fine. I don't need any. She said, oh, no, you got the pancakes. It comes with the pancakes. Well, in that case, I'll take three glasses, you know, pour away. You might leave half a glass. You wouldn't leave half a glass if you paid for it. Do you care about the quality? Yes. Do you care about the price? No, because you're not paying for it. And we're going to come back to that in a minute. Final example. Let us suppose that where you work, everybody that comes to work late has to put $5 in the kitty. And at the end of the month, they raffle it off. And so it's the last day of the month. And the boss says, John, see how much money's in there. And you count out, there's $150. And you say, buy something with it, and then we'll come down. So you're out coming back from lunch, and you forget it. And you say, oh, my goodness, I don't have time for this. What do I do? And you look around, and there in the store window is a 6-foot-tall stuffed frog. And you go over and you check the price. It says $149. Oh, that's great. That's just perfect. So you buy the frog, and you go over and you take it and you shove it in the closet. And at the end of the day, the boss invites everybody down, lectures to them about being late and all that. And everybody draws numbers, see who wins. Who wins? Sally, the new secretary, wins. What does she win? Open the door. 6-foot-tall frog. Everybody laughs and cries. Oh, that's so wonderful. That's so cute. You all go out in the parking lot, shove it into her car. Cheers. She drives off. Now, what's that called? That is called a third-party purchase. A third-party purchase is purchasing something with money that's not yours, therefore you don't care about the price. If it had been $200, he would have bought it for $200. If he had the $200, if it had been $100, he would have bought something for $100. He didn't care about the price. It's not his money. And since you're not going to consume it, you don't care about the quality. Now, this is the second time I'm now going to pause for emphasis. Because what I'm about to say is not Democrat, Republican, Socialist, Labor Party, Christian, Democrat, Tory. This is just the facts, Jack. All government purchases are third-party purchases, made with money that's not theirs to purchase things they will not personally consume. Therefore, will there be waste in the highway department? You betcha. Will there be waste in the defense department? Of course there will. That's why we believe, as Abraham Lincoln said, that government should only do those things which a man cannot do better for himself. Why? Because every time we take a dollar from an individual to save and invest and use to the maximum benefit of themselves and their family and run it through a third-party system called government, we are in the process of making the nation poorer. And as I said, you show me what percentage of the income of any city, any state, or any nation, and the principle applies. The greater the freedom, the greater the wealth. And that's all politics is about. When I was in the legislature in Ohio, we were number one in new job creation. Number one. We then systematically, new regulations, new taxes, new, and politicians, and we'll get into it in a second. They always, until now, when our current governor took office, out of the 50 states, Ohio was 49th in new job creation. And for the first time in history, Ohio Buckeyes were saying, thank God for Michigan. But nevertheless, you can make any rich place poor. You can turn this around and if you know what to do. Let me give you an example. Well, we don't have time to talk about Obamacare, but I can explain to you why Obamacare won't work. And if we can do it in a minute if we have the time left. Let's get back. Let's conclude with this. Every barroom brawl, every schoolyard scuffle boils down to two words. Who says? And there's only two answers to that. Only two. One is what I say, what man says, and the other is what God says. Those are the only two options. So how do you feel about taking innocent life, little baby life? Well, I think, or God says. And our founder said you have to start, everything starts at one place, certain primary principles of which they begin. Now, here they are. We hold these truths. Now, what is truth? I can say that this room is 45 feet wide. You can say it's 50, you can say it's 65, and you can say it's 19. And we're all fine, we're all happy, until somebody measures it. And when somebody measures it, that measurement is truth. Everything else is just opinion. But here's the problem with truth. Truth reveals error. And I can stand up here and I can talk all morning about how it's 45 feet wide. Once somebody measures it and it's 39, you know I've been wrong all this time. So error hates truth. Error wants to prevent the presentation of truth. What is truth? I am the truth and the life. So I can be an inaugural, and I can pray in the name of anything in the world. Eagle feathers and Mother Earth. I can pray in the name of anything and nobody cares. Unless I pray in the name of Jesus Christ, all hell will break loose. Why? Because I am truth. Let's hit it one more time. You're prosecuting a fella for stealing an ATM machine. And so you're in the court, and the defense counsel gets up. Why, he wouldn't do such a thing. He's such a wonderful guy. Here he was having dinner with his mother out in Portland, Oregon. I got the receipts right here. You don't care. She can say anything she wants, because when you're finished, you're going to show a video of him driving his pickup up to the ATM. And you're going to see him put the chain around, and his face is going to go in that camera. He leans over the ATM, and you got his face, and you got his fingerprints, and he pushes the button. And the truth will overcome the error. Therefore, her only hope, she has to prevent the presentation of truth. The only way she's going to win, she has to object to every introduction, because the truth overcomes error. Truth does not fear error, but error cannot tolerate truth. That's why you can't have one conservative on a college faculty. Because the one conservative, the truth will overcome the error. So they all, you can have every left-wing haywire idiot speak on campus, to spend millions of dollars. If you have one conservative, Bible-believing conservative American come for free, oh, they got to shout them down. Why? Because truth overcome, and they have to prevent the presentation of truth. Now what is truth? You know, there's only two choices. It's either what we say or what God says, and those are the two choices. When they formed Harvard, and of course the purpose of Harvard was to teach people how to serve the Lord. That was the principle, and so they had a thesis, or the theme here, of the motto for Harvard University was Veritas, which is truth, Christo Ecclesia. Truth is Christ and his church. So about 30 years ago, well, they didn't, the Christ part was too much for them. So they got rid of that, and so then they just have the Veritas. And so if you bring up the website or something, you'll see the shield, and it says Veritas, which is Latin for truth. And anybody went to Harvard, they all have their bow tie, have their ties with the Veritas seal on it and all that sort of. They chose a new president a few weeks ago. And she said this. I'm going to take four sentences out of her inaugural address. The Veritas in Harvard's shield was intended to invoke the absolutes of divine revelation, the unassailable verities of Puritan religion. We understand that quite differently now. Truth is not a possession. Truth is an aspiration. That's what I say. This is Adam and Eve in the garden. I mean, this is, I shall determine what, I shall ascend to the throne. I shall be like the Most High. I want to be God. This is just the same battle going on. And so, yet in this, we challenge, and this is why who we choose in this election is important, because they're coming after people who preach truth, and they're going to put you in jail if you read what a marriage should be and you don't agree with that. They will flat like you will. Nevertheless, here we go. Here's what it says. Here's what she said. The president of Harvard just a few weeks ago. In this, we challenge and threaten those who would embrace unquestioned certainties. Okay, you're going to try to tell me this truth. We threaten you. We're coming after you if you think there is truth. Now, our founders weren't all that long ago, by the way. I just was introduced to, the other day to a woman, introduced me to her mother, 102 years old. Okay, everybody knows somebody 100 years old. You put two of those back to back, you got George Washington. So in the history of mankind, this country's not all that old. And so when they had all these various options, they decided to do this. We hold these truths, going to have a truth, where's it going to come from? To be self-evident, which is a gracious Jeffersonian way of saying, any idiot ought to understand this. This is self-evident, bozo. You'd be blind, deaf, and dumb. You know, this is self-evident, that all men are created equal. Now, people don't want to say that this wasn't a Christian nation. Let me just ask you this. Where does this idea come from? Does it come from the various caste systems of the Hindus? Does it come from the karmas of the Buddhists? Does it come from Islam? Where do you get the idea that we're equal? Only one place, at the foot of the cross. That's right. And so, and all men are endowed by a 5-4 decision of the Supreme Court. And this is all the difference in the world. Where do rights come from? The only two choices. When Nancy Pelosi walked to the floor of the House and said, today we're going to create a right to health care, if politicians can create a right, politicians can do away with a right. There's a term for that, and it's called tyranny. And so our founders said, no. Politicians, they're not the source of our rights, are endowed by their creator. Now, let's stop and analyze this. First chapter of John. In the beginning was the Word. The Word was with God, and the Word was God. All things were made by him, and without him was not anything made that was made. And the Word became flesh and dwelt among us. So, who became flesh? Christ. So, Christ, the Word, God, Creator, they're all synonyms, right? So, is endowed by Jesus Christ, is endowed by God, is endowed by his Creator with certain inalienable rights, and among those are life. You say, no, this is above my pay grade, and it is, I don't want government involved, and this is between a woman and her doctor, and I don't think government should be involved in the bedroom. And you're in the wrong country, honey, because it says right here that to secure these rights, governments are instituted in America, it's the only nation on earth, by the way. In America, the purpose of government, number one, is to preserve innocent life. Number one, then liberty. Notice the sequence. See, liberty is a precious little value if you're dead. You have to have life first, then liberty, then sewer systems and overpasses. But the first thing you do is life. And so that And that's the distinction. Well, let's wrap it up here. There are only two worldviews. Only two. Either you believe that man created God, or you believe that God created man. End of discussion. You go to the philosophy section of any library or any bookstore, you pull down any philosophy book, you start by page 5, you can tell. Either you believe that man got here on his own, he figured this all out, climbed up out of the primordial slime and said, let's write a symphony. So man, either man, God is a creation of what man did, or you believe that God made man. And from that crossroads, everything else flows. So you tell me where a person stands, and if you believe that man created God, then you believe that man is his own standard. If you believe that God created man, then you believe that God has a standard. If you believe that man is his own standard, then you believe that man is good. By what standard would he not be good? Then if you believe that God has a standard, then you understand that we fall short. Once you see this, you'll be able to listen to a politician for 60 seconds. And you can tell. Let us suppose that you're hiring a professor at a seminary. And you ask them, do you believe in the actual physical bodily resurrection of Jesus Christ? Well, now you need to understand, in those days he could have lost the energy and he could have been... From that answer, you could tell me 50 things about that guy. I can tell you where he stands on a whole lot just from that answer. Now, once you understand this, so Senator Kaine, running for vice president, was talking to a group that was organized based upon their sexual activities. Not the number of jobs they created, the businesses they started, the neighborhoods they cleaned up, based upon the sexual activities that they engaged in. That's how the organization was formed, and that's why they had him come speak. And they wanted to explain to him that he belonged to the Catholic Church, and man decides what's right and wrong, and he needed to fix that. And so here is his response. He said, I think, talking about the way that man behaves, which is so standard. I mean, it's only been going on for thousands of years. Man does this all the time. God, nevertheless. He said, I think that's going to change. I think it's going to change because my church teaches me about a creator in the first chapter of Genesis who surveyed the entire world, and including all of mankind, and said it's very, very good, that man is very, very good. I don't think he got to chapter 3. If man was so all-fired good. So that's the difference. That's the difference. That man is his own standard. He decides. I'll decide what rights and all the rest. And if you believe that man is basically good, then you believe that anything goes wrong is not his fault. So if somebody comes in here and starts shooting people, we intuitively, by our conscience, we know that's not right. But it can't be his fault, because he's good. So whose fault is it? Well, it's got to be that gun's fault coming in here doing those nasty things. I mean, that's terrible. We need to regulate that gun coming in here behaving like that. You know, if guns kill people, how does anyone ever get out of a gun show alive? Yeah, you ever wonder how? Whereas God holds us accountable for what we do, and that's what man doesn't want. So, and then the final example, and this is critical. This is genuine. Without God, where do rights come from? They only come from power. They come from the group. My daughter just spent a year in Rwanda. 80% of the people in Rwanda are Hutu, 20% are Tutsi. 80% voted to kill the 20% over the course of 90 days with machetes. They chopped 1 million people to pieces. Now, by the way, and I want to make this clear, I don't want to get misunderstood, that's a democracy. Democracy rights come from the majority. America is not a democracy, it's a republic. It's to the republic for which it stands. A republic, ma'am, if you can keep it. You can vote 95-5 to kill Jews in America, and you can't do it. Why? Because the right to life does not come from the majority. It comes from God. And that is the distinction between the two. So you'll listen to these people, and they will always talk about women's rights. They'll talk about gay rights. They'll talk about Hispanic rights. There are no blonde left-handed rights. There's only rights that belong to everyone. They belong to everyone. And once you are in the business of getting, of taking power by the group, you can listen to a politician for 60 seconds. And they don't talk about builders and savers and parents and leaders. And they talk about an individual physical characteristic, gay rights. Can you imagine such a thing? Now, how does this play out into public policy? It works like this. If you believe in more government, if you believe that anything that goes wrong without God, you're going to have a program to fix it. And so there'll be an infinite capacity of them to come up with more and more agencies and governments and boards and bureaus because they're trying to fix it. These people know that there are only so many rights, and every right that government takes is one less I have. And so it's a zero-sum game. And our founders wanted, and this is the distinction, no other nation on earth is like this, that God gave power to people, and we, the people, loan power to government. Everybody else said that God gave power to the government, to the king, and then he loaned power to the people. America flipped that, said, no, we're the masters of government. We tell it what to do. And let me just go back and hit the democracy thing so I don't leave that hanging. America is referred to as a democracy because we democratically elect people to government to do the things that only government can do. But they're not allowed to go outside of that. And so in all intents and purposes, we are not literally a democracy, because in a democracy, the rights come from the majority. Our founders did not want that to happen, because that was exactly what was happening in France at the same time we were being formed. And so the group of people would go after, and they'd steal people's houses, and they'd cut their heads off and put it on pikes and carry it down the street and do all that kind of thing. So the word democracy does not appear in any of our founding documents, because we are a republic, but we democratically elect people to run that. But the second they get there and think they can tell us what to do, no. In a republic, we're the boss, and you do what we tell you to do. You're supposed to make it run efficiently. You're not supposed to take our rights away. So these people, how do you get more government? One way, more taxes. These people will always want more taxes, and they'll always preface it with, you know, I'm not in favor of taxes, and I really wish it didn't. But lo and behold, this the library board this month and the school board this week, and every time they always want more and more taxes. These people want fewer taxes. These people want a weak defense. These people want a strong defense. Now, this gives Katie Couric heartburn, because she says, you people claim you want limited government, fewer taxes, but you always vote for a strong defense. The answer to that is right. You're exactly correct. Because limited government preserves our freedom, and fewer taxes gives us more freedom. And a strong defense protects our freedom, and that is what government is supposed to do, is to protect our freedom. And so you tell me where a person stands on this. For example, Ronald Reagan, when he became president, they explained to him that over the last 8 to 10 years, the Soviet Union had developed these missiles that they could come and blow us up. And he said, what can we do about that? And he said, we can't do anything. He said, that's not a very good program. And he said, I think we ought to shoot down the missile before they hit us. No, we could never do that. Well, that's an impossibility. My goodness, you can't hit a bullet with a bullet. He said, we're Americans. What do you mean we can't? Let's give it a try. And so he developed a thing called the Strategic Defense Initiative. Strategic defense, that is, we're going to knock it down. They called it Star Wars and laughed about it. But in short order, we could hit the bullet with the bullet. And so Israel was getting rockets coming in. And so we gave that program to Israel. But to protect America, you had to go out into the atmosphere. And so now, rather than saying we want them to hit us, we say, we're protecting the environment. So Congress passed a law that you could not test a missile that went out into outside the atmosphere, which meant you couldn't defend America. You could defend Europe, you could defend Israel, but you couldn't defend America. Finally, when the Congress changed, a new president under George Bush signed an agreement that finally we would be able to defend ourselves. And you have to have a triangulation, because you got altitude, latitude, and longitude. So you have to have the three of them. And the final piece was that the missiles would be in Poland, and the radar would be in the Czech Republic, and then with Alaska and all, they'd work. And that was to go into effect on May 2009, and America would then be defended. If you back up 10 years ahead of that, there were 8 people running for president on this side. All 8 of them promised that if they became president of the United States, they would make sure that if Russia or China or Iran sent a missile by accident or design, they would make sure that it hit us. And these people said, no, we will complete the strategic defense to shoot the missile down before it hits us. Well, as you know, on January of 2009, we got a new president. And the first thing he did was to cancel that. And at this moment, if a missile was sent to America, we cannot. Now, you show me where a person stands on that issue, and I will tell you within a 90% certainty where they stand on cutting the capital gains tax. Now, when I did that to my dad, my father said, Bob, you're crazy. I said, no. There is a worldview, and that's when I used the one about that, because he studies the Bible a lot. And so I asked him, he said, if you ask this person, he said, do you believe in the actual virgin birth of Jesus Christ? Well, now, virgin in those days, that just meant a young girl. Well, you know, I said, you could tell me 50 things. He said, well, I could. I said, well, that's your business, Dad. I'm going to tell you about my business. My business is that you show me where these people stand on these, and since I am the standard, no God, I am the standard, I can determine that marriage is between 3 men and a horse. And then I can make it a hate crime if you laugh at my definition of marriage. Man without God loses standards, loses his liberty, and ultimately ends up losing his life. And so that's why we see this tremendous effort to take God out of our daily life. Take God out of the Pledge of Allegiance, to take the cross off of the city seal, San Jose, to say that you can pray in your closet, but don't you dare come out here at an event at a ball game. Why? We'll lock you up, Coach. We will put you in jail. They want to separate God from the nation that was founded on those principles that allowed it to prosper, unlike any other nation on earth. Now, there's a term when you want to separate from God. It's called sin. Sin is anything that separates us from God. And sin, when it is conceived, bringeth forth death. The wages of sin is death. There is a way that seemeth right unto a man, but the end thereof are the ways of death. What are the ways of death? Abortion, infanticide, euthanasia, right to die legislation, drug addiction, alcoholism, death. But I am come that ye might have life. I am the way, the truth, and the life. He that hath the Son hath life. And so there is a life and death struggle. There is this is a spiritual battle. This is a spiritual battle. And if we do not recognize it as such, we will allow this hope. The cost of global evangelism. For spreading the gospel around the world. If you took all of the money that's contributed to spreading the gospel around the world, you took the 96% that aren't Americans, you took all of that money and you doubled it, and you tripled it, and you did it 6.5 times, it still wouldn't be as much as what the 4% Americans. This is the lighthouse for the gospel. Now, do you think Satan knows that? Do you understand? The scripture says if you want to take a city, you must bind a strong man. There's only one strong man in the world. You knock the United States down, everything else is a piece of cake. There's only one. When a ship is attacked on the high seas, as happened over 300 times last year, to whom can they appeal? Only one group. 329,000 Americans wear the uniform of the United States Navy. When you undo America, you then have free reign in the world. And I did the prayer breakfast in Kiev, Ukraine, about 6 weeks ago. And they had the foreign ministers, and they had the parliamentarians, and then the president, and they only prayed about two things. Number one is they're being overrun by the Russians. There's 6 million displaced people in the country, and they can't, the older people, like their mothers and grandparents, they can't communicate with them because they didn't want to leave their house, and now they're surrounded and all. They prayed about that, and for the leadership of the United States of America, that we would choose leadership that understand what's happening around the world. We formed a group of prayer groups in each of the seven countries of the Baltics, of the Balkans, Slovenia, Croatia, Serbia, Albania, etc. And once a year, that was about 20 years ago, once a year they have a gathering, and one of those countries hosts. This year, Serbia hosted in Belgrade. At this, 156 parliamentarians, three prime ministers, several cabinet ministers, they prayed about two things. They prayed about their country, and they all prayed for the leadership of America, because they are at the risk of what America does, and they have no say. You have the say. You control what happens, and they're praying that God will give you the wisdom to choose what is right. With that, God bless. Good to see you.
One second. You can be seated, but Mr. McEwen, you don't get away that easy. I want to just take a minute because I'm almost like, wow, a lot of information, incredible perspective. Was that, y'all getting me? Let's take a few questions, because I think this is the one guy I've heard him even field questions, and throw the hard ones. Go for it. Who, do you have questions now? I want to just take a few questions before we move to the next thing, but I don't want to just quickly move past this and glaze over it and say, well, that's his perspective, because I think one of the fundamental things, the thing that's real interesting, he didn't hear yesterday's speaker talk about Veritas. He wasn't around. And I don't even think he spoke to Dr. Piper between yesterday and today, right? And so it's an interesting theme that has been rung through with what we're hearing. So perhaps, just perhaps, we didn't plan it, perhaps the Lord is speaking. Dr. Hunter.
Go ahead and take on Obamacare.
I knew that was a question.
Let me explain. I think you might find it of interest, because then you can understand. We have to go back to the chart. So whenever there's something wrong in the economy, politicians say, I want to fix it. Let me tell you, a thing will fix itself on its own unless a politician gets involved. A politician will mess it up. Like, for example, they'll say, well, if we don't have government controlling the economy, we'll have monopolies. You cannot have a monopoly without government. I cannot make you pay $12 for a hamburger. Because the second I try to sell a $12 hamburger, somebody's going to come right beside me and sell it for $2, and I'll be out of business. Unless I can go to the city council, and I can get the concession for the stadium, and I can put policemen at the gate and rummage through your purse to make sure you don't bring anything in. And then when you're sitting there for 4 hours, you'll pay $12 for my hamburger because I have the monopoly. You can only have a monopoly with government. So whenever you see something that's haywire, when you see something that's fouled up in the economy, you have to look for government. I asked this question. When was the last time you heard someone complain about the cost of their home insurance? Nobody ever does. But if they did, what's the first thing you would say? Well, try my guy.
Yeah.
It could be fixed. Healthcare is the only one that's messed up. Do we have quality healthcare? You betcha, the finest in the world. When you're the Prime Minister of Canada, you send your sister, you could put her at the head of the line in Canada, but you send her to America to get heart surgery because it's the best in the world. You go to Rochester, Minnesota, finest airport in that little town. Why? Because the Mayo Clinic's there. And if you're a billionaire from the Middle East, you fly your 747 to the finest healthcare in America, but the price is all fouled up.
It's true.
Why?
It's true.
Well, let's look to government. And in December 7th, 1941, America was attacked, and we went to war. In 1942, 6 million young men sign up, and they're all going off to war, and politicians are going to help. And so they say, well, if they're making a sacrifice of their life and limb, then we should sacrifice here as well. And so therefore, we should have a wage and price freeze. No one should make a profit while during the war. We should just work, and nobody should get a pay raise during the war. And that sounds good, but if you're North American Rockwell in Southern California, and you want an engineer from Illinois, and I can't pay you any more to live in Southern California and move all the way out here and change your kids. And what's the incentive to come? And the whole thing's starting to foul up. And the labor unions go into FDR and say, whoa, we're taking money out of their pocket every week. You're going to tell us we can't get them a pay raise, can't do anything with them. That's not so good for us. And that's not good for us. That ain't so good for you either, bro. And so being a liberal means never having to say you're sorry. So you never admit, well, I might have done something wrong. So they said, let's do this. How about if you unions negotiate to have the employer pay for their life insurance, pay for their car insurance, pay for their home, pay for their health, that's it. If they'll pay for their health insurance, we will not count it as a pay raise. And so, in 1942, 5% of the people in America had somebody else purchasing their health. By 1945, 85% of the people in America had someone else purchasing their health care. Do we care about the quality? Yes. Do we care about? No, we're not paying for it. So you're going to see the doctor. The doctor says, I want these 7 tests. You say, well, doctor, now how much are those? He'll look at you like a cow looking at a new gate. I mean, I don't know how much they are. You're not paying for them anyway. And so when we're not paying for them, we don't care about the price. So the price is all cattywampus and haywire. Now, you got two options. One would be, how about if we do away with the provision that gives the tax deduction only to the businesses, and we allow individuals to purchase their own health insurance, and we have 330 million Americans go out tomorrow to buy health insurance. You know what? That little gecko, he'll be selling a little more coverage for a little less cost. I mean, that woman at Progressives, you know, you come here, I'll give you, this thing could right itself in 24 hours. As everybody would say, I'll fix it. Or, here's an alternative. Why don't we let those good, compassionate folks down at the Bureau of Motor Vehicles? You know, the ones that say, take a number to sit here for 3 weeks. You know, why don't we put them in charge? And those folks that run the Social Security Administration, you know, they're so good at keeping records. Why don't we turn it over to government? Why don't we let them do it? Now, you understand the choice? Let me just stop back a second. Suppose they had decided, rather than to pay your health insurance, suppose they had decided to pay your mortgage. And we would be 60 years later and say, isn't it terrible? You lose your job, you lose your house. That'd be terrible, boy. Yeah, that'd be dumb as a post. That's stupid. I should be in charge of that. And he said, well, isn't it terrible? You lose your job, you lose your health care. Yes, that's stupid. That's seriously dumb. I don't want to lose the insurance on my car just because I lost my job. I should be able to handle these things. I don't want somebody else purchasing and telling me what I'm supposed to buy. A 66-year-old man having pregnancy coverage, I don't need it. So you think I'm joking?
Yeah, you're right.
Y'all know Jim Dobson? There's 5 of us on Jim Dobson's board. We're in a lawsuit with the president at the moment. Because we have to pay for abortion coverage. And Jim Dobson says, I'm not going to do it. I am not going to do it. And they said, you're going to go to jail. And so, because when you lose your right to choose, you lose your freedom. That's what, and that, so here it is. Lest you think our competitors understand exactly. So October, 6 years ago, let's go back and look at it again. You saw the two choices. The choice is where individuals do it on their own. Here's where we are now, where it's a halfway, and the alternative is where government does it all. And so here's what he says, and I'm quoting. It says, those on the left believe that the only way to fix the system is through a single-payer system like Canada's. Now, when he says that, the folks on the left get so excited they stand on their chair and whistle and throw their hats and carry on. He has to wait for them to settle down a little bit so he can continue on. While we're talking about Canada, if you want to see a Canadian doctor in November, go to Florida. Because you're only allowed to earn so much. And once they've reached that, they can't take, if they work go any more work, they can't, so they leave. So they all go to Florida in November and December. And you ought to see the number. There are more MRI machines in Columbus, Ohio than there are in the nation of Canada. So I went to school at the University of Miami, and they kept telling how great everything was in Cuba. And in Cuba, they had free electricity. Well, great. It was only on 3 hours a night. You only had one light bulb. They controlled the light bulbs, you know, but they leave all this stuff out. So nevertheless, okay, the single payer system in Canada, where we would severely restrict. What happens when government makes decisions for you? You lose your freedom. Fewer choices, less freedom. I'm not putting words in it. Here's what he's saying. Where we would severely restrict the private insurance market and have the government provide coverage for everybody. Next sentence, it's not like he doesn't know what he's talking about. Next sentence is this. On the right are those who argue that we should end employer-based systems and leave individuals to buy health insurance on their own, poor little things. At this point, if I were in Congress, that's when I would have been standing on the chair. I said, you're darn tootin'. This is exactly what you ought to do. If I can pay my mortgage, if I can buy my car insurance, if I can buy my home insurance, I can buy my health insurance. And if I don't like it, I'll get one that I like it. So that's it. Mm.
That's good. See, that's a fundamental unique belief difference. And if we believe that the MVA is going to run our healthcare system better than what we can do ourselves, and I think, you know, and I'm not really restating it, the light bulbs are just going off and just understanding simply that competitiveness that comes into the industry once we begin to buy our own balances the market. Makes sense. That's what they teach us in school. Let me ask you another quick question, then we're going to move on. But what are the sources of the automobile industry collapse in 07, 08, what the change in the Midwest, and has this, and why has this impacted America so bad in terms of jobs?
That's a simple little question. It's a series of things. Number one is that when the market changes, you have to be able, if you're running a clothing store and nobody's buying your clothes, you have to lower the prices and have a sale or do something. You have to respond to the marketplace. Labor unions do not allow flexibility. And so when the competition was coming in and they wanted to say that they wanted people to work weekends or whatever changes that they want to make, some are real silly. Let me just give you one example in Cleveland. I was speaking for a group. And we were supposed to be in the Coliseum there, but the Cavaliers won. And so they moved us down to the first time in history of mankind. So we had to go down to the auditorium, to the Masons, what's it called? Scottish Rite Auditorium. And so we go down there, and that's unionized. And so they backed up the speaker system to put it onto there's a drawer there, and then here's the stage. And, of course, there's the seats out there. In order to bring the speakers and things up onto the stage, it took 5 unions. All of them had to be paid for 8 hours. So only the Teamsters could back it up, and only the dock people could load it off of the boat, only the stage hands could bring it up onto the stage. Only the electricians could plug it in, and of course then you're trying to get them to work and they won't. And so the guy that was in charge went down and got a bunch of $100 bills. And he said, I'm gonna pay you 8 hours. You understand that? Here's $100. Go get a hot dog and let us do this. And so they all left, and when we loaded the thing up and got the thing all done in an hour. But the point, what's the point? The point is, do they ever want to go back there again? No. And so Cleveland is second only to Detroit in places that you want to avoid because of these people that say they're going to do you a favor. When the auto industry wanted to bring in new technology, the labor union said, you can't do that. And so the efficiency of the machines were such that they continually got further and further out of the market. That meant they had to up the price. When they upped the price, young girls in their 20s no longer had the loyalty to Ford or to Chevrolet that we all felt in the 1950s. And so they started to buy the Hondas and the other things, and the auto industry began to topple. And it was just about to go back and restructure it. Now, here's the thing about a bankruptcy. You should understand about a bankruptcy. A bankruptcy doesn't mean that you go out of business. A bankruptcy means that this is so fouled up, we got to go through this and do this again. And so a bankruptcy goes into Chapter 11, in which they renegotiate the various agreements so that then they can operate at a profit. And that's where it was in 2008. It was right at that point where the American industry was just about to survive, and it didn't, because the American government came in and gave them a whole bunch of money to keep doing what they're doing and bailed them out to just continue at that stage. And now we're continuing to see the American production market continue to lose market share when it was just on the cusp of coming at them with the gangbusters, where we wouldn't have to, they have to ship everything over here. They have to bring the tires over, bring the glass, all around. We'd have it all right here if we could just meet the market. But when you have those rigid parts that won't let them change, that was what the dilemma was. And I repeat, we were this far from fixing it.